What's up, everybody? I wanted to do a review on my new Starball. It's actually the DMX version of the Starball from American DJ. You don't see a whole lot of reviews on them, so I figured I'd do something, give people a little bit idea of what's going on with it. You'll see what we have here is the DMX side of things. It's pretty basic dip switch. I've actually grown to prefer a lot of the digital displays and things like that over the dip switches. It's not real hard to get used to. It's just a little bit better to have it at a glance with the digital display rather than the dip switches. You'll see it's got that little blinky LED on there. I'm assuming that just lets you know that the DMX is active. It also does have the you're not gonna be able to see it there real easy. Let's see if I can zoom in here. There you go, it does have the description on the side if you do have any questions while you're setting it up, and in the book as well. Here you'll see the other side of the Starball with the DMX in, DMX out. You see that I have the actual Terminator resistor on this one, as this is the last fixture in my set, so that's what that is. Does have that nice little plug for the not included remote control. I don't know what the price is on that, but if you're running DMX, I don't really see a need for it. You'll also see the mic. It does not have a sensitivity, which a lot of the other fixtures have, and I kind of like that. Just it's nice to be able to dial it down or dial it up sometimes. You also have the fuse here. The one thing I really think that American DJ missed the boat on is the power cord. I've really grown accustomed to most of the fixtures having the, I believe it's the IEC power cord. It's nice. I understand real estate is a premium on a light like this, but I just think that it's something that they could have made room for. Some people like them, some people don't. I just think this way you don't have an option eventually that, you know, you can pack that thing up a few times and the cord could start to fray right at the base of the grommet there. Next thing you know, you can't really fix it in the field short of taking the whole thing apart and resoldering it. It does have the fuse right above it. It's a nice feature as well. I believe it is auto voltage sensing. So if you have a 220 system, it will auto sense. Now, a little bit about that bracketing system there. I think it's kind of nice that they did allow you the option. That way you can just take the U-shaped bracket off and set it on top of a sub or on top of a speaker or something like that if you would like. It just kind of made it a little bit more versatile. And then to have those cooling fins down there and then they spaced it up, that was actually another nice feature. You can see here I've got that hardware, which is not supplied by American DJ. They do supply you some, but I didn't like it. I thought the lock nut was a little bit cheapish, so I went with some grade 8 hardware. I know grade 8 is way above what anybody would ever need on a fixture like this, however, it's what I had. So that's the story on that. Like I was saying, this is the DMX version. This is the manual that comes with it. You'll see the manual is pretty sparse. It does a fairly decent job of explaining things, but here's the nice thing about it. It does have the nice DMX table in there, kind of lets you know what's going on if you do have the numerical display. One thing I notice, however, is there is no sound activated mode in DMX. Another thing I think they kind of missed the boat on. Sure, a lot of controllers have a sound activated feature, but it is nice to be able to set a single feature to a strobe during sound activated mode. Well, maybe you have your others set at a static, or you know, you want to run a scene for more than 30 seconds with some sound in it. So like you say, I think that could be a real nice future improvement. Alright, like I said, it does have a two-channel DMX. So while it's still light out here, we're going to just take a look and see kind of how the channels react and what's going on with that. So let's we'll turn the fixture on here. And in this case here, I have it set for number 7. That's just happens to be where I have it. You see I put a little label here so I know exactly what's going on. And then it's just real basic, like the manual shows. You're not going to be able to see a whole lot of lighting here on my bare basement floor. But it does give you, you know, here's your speed, left or right, or clockwise, counterclockwise, static, and however fast or slow you want to move it. It does make a little bit of noise, I noticed, when it's spinning. Not that you would ever notice if you had any sort of music on. It's one of the things I noticed when I was setting it up. And then your brightness is the other channel. One thing I do like, too, is that when you get to about, well, there, you can see I don't have the numerics on the Martin Freaky. But that's where it starts to strobe, and it gives you a real nice slow strobe. But the other thing that I really do like about it is, rather than trying to come back down and find where you're not strobing to where you're at maximum, you just go straight all the way up to the top. It's going to give you what they call the open. I'm assuming they mean, you know, as if you were using a shutter or something like that. So it's just real basic if you were just trying to turn that fixture on. You're not trying to, you know, run up and down the dial trying to find, oh, is that 100% output or what the deal is. You just flip it all the way up and you're good to go.
I want to take this minute to introduce you to my people.
This one is for
for Newcastle, where venom comes from.